Forgive us, O God. Calm our hearts, settle our souls. Renew in us the ability to find our comfort in you.
Amen.
Let us take a moment of silent personal confession. Friends, hear this good news. In Jesus Christ, who was brought into this world to walk in our midst, to teach us, to guide us, and to ultimately die for us, who was raised for us, in Christ our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Christ be with you all. I invite you to share that peace with one another. Amen. You may be seated. As we prepare to hear our scripture passages this morning, let us go to God in a prayer of illumination. Gracious, loving God, we ask you pour your Spirit upon us. Help us to hear and understand and discern your will for us. Reveal to us within your words this morning. And if there are words spoken that are not yours, let them fall away and do no harm. We ask for all these things in the name of our Rock and our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first scripture passage this morning will be Psalm 98. Let us hear these ancient poetic words. Oh, sing the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gotten him victory. The Lord has made known his victory. He has revealed his vindication in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands, let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity. And then let us hear from Luke 21, 5 through 19. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon the other. All will be thrown down." They said to him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign for this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'The time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nations will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues. And there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all of this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, And you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance. For I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by your parents and siblings, by relatives and friends. They will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name. But not a hair on your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God. So, truthfully, our gospel lesson this morning deals with a subject that can easily frighten many. Many try to predict its coming and can be caught off guard. In most Christian settings, we even talk about the second coming of Christ, right? Connected to this destruction of the temple. When will this take place? Right, Christ says in Mark 13:32-33, but of that day or of that hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Take heed, watch, for you do not know when the time will come. And just like then when Jesus was talking to his disciples, we hear, like, take heed, be prepared. Be ready. I always laugh, actually, when I read this passage. I just now remembered it, this passage in Mark. I grew up going to church all the time with my parents. And our drive home, often my dad and I would get in debates, as we called it. My mom said we were arguing, but it was debating. And I remember distinctly one time, this passage being the point of our discussion, and no one ever will know the time. And I joke with my father, I was like, so really? So if I guess right, God's like, crap, I gotta change it. Right? No. It's not down to that detail, I don't think. But this message this morning, I think, needs to be held in tension. We're told to be on guard, be alert, to be prepared. But only in the right way. I was told once about a story that the devil was trying to plan how he was going to corrupt and destroy this world of God's creation. And in discussions with his minions, he's talking about how he will use anger and greed and envy and all of these other things to destroy our lives. And then one of his minions spoke up and said, I want to go talk to the people about all the things that God wants them to be and do. I want to encourage them to follow the plans and purposes of God. And of course, the devil's like, what are you talking about? And then the minion went on and said, however, I want to tell them that there is no hurry. They don't have to pay too close attention. You can wait until tomorrow. But why don't you spend the time doing the things that you prefer to do or you'd rather be doing? And the devil laughed and said, you are the one who shall go and destroy and corrupt the earth. And I thought, well, you know, that's probably the most appropriate story I've heard about all that. As Jesus and his disciples were in the temple, the disciples couldn't help themselves but be appalled at the splendor of the temple they saw before them. The accomplishments of those who built it gave them a sense of beauty and wonder in this place. And many thought that temple, that building, that for them was the very house of God, would save them by them being there and worshiping there. In many ways, that temple embodied their saving, right? Is what we would call a Messiah, a Savior. And Jesus took the time to point out to them that just like that building, just like other people that currently existed in Jewish society, there were false messiahs. false things that can save you. He told them, as for these things which you see, the day will come when they shall not be. They will not be here. A stone is removed from one another and they are thrown down. He's trying to tell them to be prepared for that day. That day which they can't fathom, right? If I told you, hey, you need to be ready, be prepared for all these things that are going to unfold that you never want to see unfold, you're probably going to ignore it, right? Because we don't want to think about that. We don't. That's where they are. He's reminding them to look closely for false messiahs in the world around them. I want to talk briefly about what those false messiahs might be for us. Because we don't quite wrap ourselves into a temple, a place, as much then. Some of us don't follow people who are false messiahs as much. It happens, but not that much anymore. So what are our false messiahs we might encounter? One of them, for me, in my opinion, in our world around us, is our false messiah in a false sense of pride in one's own accomplishments. Our own accomplishments, what we do can save us. Don't think that's true. What about our technologies, our wonder, drugs and medication, our military might, our defense systems, our political cults, our own egos, those false messiahs we think will save us? Jesus warns his own disciples, and we should hear that warning, do not be led astray, take heed. For many will come in my name, saying that I am he, and time is at hand. Do not go after that. I've only seen a few times in my life, short life by most measures, when people have actually said they're following somebody like they are Jesus. That makes me extremely nervous and scared. Take heed of false messiahs. But we follow things. We're led astray. We just do. Something about our nature. There's a reason Jesus was telling us to pay attention. Latest fads, comfort of our abundance, power of a business community, a false sense that somehow through more money we can become rich, our lives can be secure. False messiahs. Things that will save us. A poet said it well when they wrote, trust in yourself and you are doomed to disappointment. Trust in your friends and they will die and eventually leave you. Trust in money and you have it taken from you. Trust in reputation and some slanderous tongues may blast it. But trust in God and you are never to be confounded in time or eternity. Where is our Messiah? The thing that will save us. And the next warning takes place in verse 9 when Jesus speaks of God's time coming, as he says, and when you hear of wars and tumult, do not be terrified. This first must take place, and the end will be here at once. Jesus is saying that God's time in beginning is not expected. It might be through way of suffering, of evil, times of conflict. But in the end of all that, God is controlled. God is breaking through. Maybe not in the way we expect it. I tell people all the time, maybe it's God saying, okay, you've tried all of your ways, right? Through power, through conflict, through dominance, through violence. You've tried your way. Those things will come, right? And then I'm going to try mine. We've heard that over and over in Scripture as well. I'll let you sit back and do your thing, and then I'm going to come in and do mine and take it all. Take care of it. unexpected coming. No one knows the time or place. Even then, Jesus warned, the temple will be torn down. I'm not going to tell you when. It will happen. Jesus won't come again. When? I cannot tell you. I do not know, and I'm not going to spend my time trying to figure it out. Not a wise use of my time. But we must be prepared. As it says in 2 Peter, but do not forget one thing, my dear friends. There is no difference in the Lord's sight between one day and 1,000 years. The two are the same. Time is not a thing that God thinks of the way we do. But that question, are you prepared? There's two messages in this passage that kind of are held in tension. I'm sitting here saying, telling you, be prepared, right? And the message title is what? What did I put down here? Do not prepare, right? You're like, well, somebody had a typo. No, not really. We heard in verses 14 and 15, so make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance. I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. So be prepared, but do not prepare. What are we doing? Right? First, we look at it closely and we hold them in tension together. I like the way English works, and I like the way the Greek language works even more. Be prepared. Be something. To embody something. To live something is different than to prepare, right? Get that? To live embodied in something is different to prepare. I put it this way, to be prepared, I'm not thinking of how I'm going to respond to somebody when they say X, Y, and Z, or this happens, what will I do, right? I need to stack my stuff up if I'm a prepper and whatever, like, right? That's to prepare. I'm not saying that's always a bad thing, right? We just made a whole bunch of pies. You had to prepare for that, right? And Jesus was telling us, do not prepare for what's going to take place. Don't try to think through how you're going to respond to stuff. Don't try to think through the scenarios. Don't try to think through the wars that will come, how I'm going to retaliate. Don't think about that. Do not prepare. But you need to be prepared for God's coming. Right? You need to live and embody the right way of living that I have told you about. And in Christ, it's living out that love and grace and mercy, being that. And if you are being that, you don't have to worry about trying to prepare. You are. There might be semantics, but do you get the difference in that? You are prepared if you be what God has asked us to be. I don't have to worry about the day when somebody calls me and says, why have you done this, this, and this? What is your faith? I live what I believe. I am being prepared. I don't have to worry to what will come tomorrow. I don't have to think about the wars that may happen, the conflict that will happen. I don't have to worry about that. That's the stuff God has handled. I have to live in grace and love and mercy and kindness here and now. I have to be what God has asked me to be. That's what he's trying to tell his disciples. He's trying to tell them, I have been with you and told you how to live in this world in a different way. You need to be that and be prepared for what is coming. Don't worry about preparing for the worldly things that you may see and encounter. I know that's a hard differential thing for us to make in our lives and our world, but I think it's important. Christ came to this earth to teach us how to be. Right? And if we listen, and if we apply those things in our life, no matter what unfolds, we will be okay. I use a story to illustrate this. My father and his 8-year-old son and 10-year-old girl were all good swimmers, great swimmers. He had taught his children how to swim and how to survive in water. And one summer day, they were off the coast of New Jersey, swimming. Some distance from shore, they became separated, and they realized, the father especially realizes, that his daughter and they were starting to drift further to sea. And he called out to his daughter, who he realized she's not going to be able to make it back to shore, but his son and him could. And he called out to her, "Your brother and I are going to make it ashore for help. If you get tired, turn on your back like I taught you, and you can float all day on your back. I will come for you." And before long, many boats were on the ocean searching for this girl. 4 hours later, they found her far from shore. She was calmly swimming on her back and was not frightened at all. She simply stated, "My father said he would come for me, and then I could float all day." So that's what I did. She was being what she was taught to be. Not focused on what could come next, not trying to prepare, but just being what she had already been taught to be. That is what we have been gifted with. That's what preparedness is. It's not a hard thing. It's really not. You can open up the Beatitudes and a few passages in Scripture, and you can look at them and say, look, this is what it means to be what God has asked us to be. You can look beyond what Christ told us, obviously. Now, some of my colleagues cringe at that in Christianity, but look in Hebrew Scripture. Be what God has asked us to be. Gave rules and times and places to follow this, but the heart of what God asked people to be from creation hasn't changed all that much. So my friends, let us be assured, let us be prepared for the world we have been gifted in Christ's coming.
Amen.
Friends, I invite you to join with me in our affirmation of faith, and we'll use the brief statement of faith that you can find in the back of your hymnal. Let us say together, we trust in God, the Holy Spirit,
everywhere and everywhere in the world of life.
The Spirit justifies us by grace
through faith,
sets us free
to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, cleanses us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the Church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing,
to witness among all peoples Christ as Lord and Savior,
to unmask idolatries in church and culture,
to hear the voices of people's long silence,
and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily lives and to live holy and joyful lives,
even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth.
Pray and call on the Lord Jesus.
With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or death can separate us from the love of God and Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Friends, let us sing together hymn 428. Come to you in prayer to say thank you. Thank you for everything we've been gifted. Thank you for this family of faith. Thank you for the air we breathe and moments together. We give thanks for opportunities of our family to get to travel and learn from different places in the world. And we give thanks for having some of the work done in Darjeeling highlighted and shared with our presbytery. And we give thanks that we can come to you in prayer in our times of need. For those who find themselves ill in hospitals, fighting things from COVID, pneumonia to cancers, recovering from strokes, we ask you to be with them all. We ask you to be with those who may find themselves isolated as we move forward into holiday season. Difficult times. We ask you offer them comfort and support in their times of need. And we ask for prayers for those who know the sting and reality of death. Give them reminders of the resurrection. And give them strength in those times of difficulty. In all of these things, we ask you hear us as we pray together. As your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Friends, we've come to the time where we're able to give of ourselves for the work of God in this world. We ask God to inspire us on what we are called to give, of our time, our talents, of our times. I invite you to join with me in our prayer of dedication. God of the wolf and the lamb, the lion and the ox, we give thanks for these gifts and pray that they might be agents of your peace. May they serve your creation as we seek your new heaven and your new earth. Help us take these gifts into a world filled with distress and conflict, filled with pain and heal it, filled with silence and speak up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, let us sing together hymn 367.
Thank you.
Friends, as we leave this place, let us go into God's world prepared. Be all that God has asked us to be, showing love, grace, and mercy to everyone we meet, now and always. Amen.
Amen.